such a nice, warm day we have today, at least inside. How many times are you thankful for heat when it gets this cold? I was thinking yesterday how nice it was to have air conditioning when it was really hot, and then how quickly we need heat when it was, we're just picky people, that's all there is to it. I want to welcome you this morning. There's a few visitors here this morning that are here for our membership and baptism, and thank you for coming. And I was really looking forward to this day, and I was really disappointed when we had to cancel last week, but the Lord knows what He's doing, and I'm not sure last week I could have done any baptisms because my back was out. So it's still not in, but it's better than it was. So a couple real quick things I want to mention. I am going to go ahead and live stream the first portion of this service, but when we get to the ceremony for membership, I'm going to shut that off. There are some that are watching online, so I thought at least we'd do that for them. And I also just want to read a couple of thank yous real quick before we get started. Dear Montgomery Church family, thank you, thank you, thank you for your most generous gift from the birthday and anniversary offerings. That money will be very useful in meeting some of my health care costs. Thank you again. May God richly bless you. Philippians 4:18-20. I have all I need because of your generosity. God will bless you for giving. And that's Jack Horner. A very grateful man. Very encouraging to listen to him talk. Dear Montgomery friends, thank you from the bottom of our hearts for the generous love offering you gifted to our family, also for the Walmart gift card. These things have been so helpful and appreciated. We are grateful for all the prayers sent to our Father on our behalf. May each of you receive many blessings and Christian love to his songs. And really glad to hear that she's doing so much better. All right, at this time, if you would grab your hymnal, we are going to sing.
Take your red hymnal, new hymnal, and turn to number 532. Number 532.
Bye.
number 624. Number 624. Schedules here today, and so we have maybe a slight bit more time than what we originally had. So I had debated not having a time of sharing and praise and prayer requests, but I think we'll have time to do that. If there's anyone that just has something on your heart you'd like to share, go ahead and do that at this time. Are you glad Jesus came into your heart?
I'd like to thank everyone for the prayers while I was down, plus my granddaughter is doing so much better. She still has some congestion, but like the next day after we reached out to everyone's church families, her fever broke the next day. It was just wonderful that she didn't have to go to the hospital.
There's something really special about being able to just reach out to friends and family for prayer. What do I do without it? Anybody else?
Yeah, I want to give a praise and advice.
Oh boy.
I don't know who wrote this, let's take the inventory in the bulletin this morning. But to the husbands, don't read it with your wife. It could start an argument. But me being a troublesome soul that I am, I thought to myself, look at, oh, you need to change this, you need to change that. But my advice is this, and I'm going to yield to it. Remember, it's to you, not your wife.
I don't honestly know. Which one is that?
Oh, let's take the inventory. It's all of it.
As we start the new year.
Oh, okay. Okay. You know? I need to look at that.
Yeah. Go read it with your wife.
Well, you know. Might be a good sermon there, huh, John?
It could be. We could work that in there.
Okay, I'm going to look at that. Somebody else.
We've had a lot of concerns in our heart this past week with Bill's new health issue, and it really tends to put you down. But after singing those songs, how can you be down? Mm-hmm. Because it put your focus right where it ought to be. Jesus is with you. So you don't need to be down. You don't have to worry because God will take care of you.
Yeah.
He's been taking care of us all these years. And so I am just so thankful.
Has he ever failed you, Ruth?
Never.
There's a testimony. Jesus doesn't fail.
Amen.
Thank you for sharing. Claire, I think I saw your hand.
Yeah, I talked to my mother the other night, and he went up to the doctor again, and the cancer was gone. They also picked him back faster now.
Oh, boy. My brother one time had a similar situation. I think he was on top of the stack of rafters. They were on the building, and they all went, and he went with them. Well, trusses. That wasn't the first time he fell either. Somebody else.
Yeah. When it was brought up about using the prayer chain, it always just makes me think of when Aiden, when we found out he had type 1 diabetes, and Shauna, our daughter, found out through the prayer chain that Aiden was in the hospital being rushed to Hershey, and she still teases me about that, like, why didn't I call her first, why did I call to have him put on the prayer chain first, but anyway, funny story, but it also, this day makes me think of when I joined the church, and how thankful I am for this church family. It just for so many reasons, and you know, everybody's always there for prayer, for advice, or just listening, or for a laugh, and it's just made a world of, you have all made a world of difference in my life, and I'm so thankful.
I love hearing that. Pam's been just an amazing part of our church for the most part. Just real blessing, Pam. Somebody else? Claire?
Yeah, I like Jennifer Diane too. She worked with retirement.
Oh. So, how did you manage that, Diane?
Well, she didn't have a light on, and she went out around the torque. She had whoops.
Okay, wow. Maybe she was feeling sympathy for you, Claire, and she wanted to be laid up till. Let's pray for her. I can also keep Brian Harbaugh in your prayers. Carla texted me and said he was sick. Flu-like stuff and whatnot, and then texted me this morning and said his cellulitis is back. So she's pretty sure that's what's causing his sickness, so doesn't sound very good right now, so just really pray for him. Who else? For those of you that have a part in the service this morning, if you're becoming a member or being baptized, just relax. It's just us. It's just, this is a very special time and don't need to be worried about it. It's, I don't know how to explain it, but it's a really special thing for me. And yeah, just relax and just enjoy the day. We all done? All right, let's bow for prayer. Lord, thank you that we can come to you. We thank you for our church. We thank you for the fact that, as we heard this morning from Pam, that just church has made a big impact on lives. We just praise you for that. We pray that you'll continue to bless us as a church. We thank you for what you're doing here, and we see the growth that we're seeing here this morning, and we're excited, and we just praise you and help us to continue to be your servants and to be guided by you and be your vessels, be used by you. Just bless us in a very, very special way this morning. Would you just help everyone that has a part just to relax and just trust that this is a special time and that you're going to give them strength and calm nerves to get through it. Pray you'll just be with those this morning that are struggling physically. Think of Brian right now. Give him a special touch. Just work things out that he would have healing. Be with Tim and Glenda this morning. Steve and Susie. Jack Horner. Continue to be with Bill and Ruth, and we're thankful they can be here today. I think of Claire's brother that got a bad report here this week, and I pray just work in his life and give him peace. Be with his friend, Claire's friend that was in an accident, and give him healing. Be with Diane, give her healing as well. We just thank you, Lord, that we can bring our needs to you. I know there's pretty much everyone here probably has something weighing on their hearts that is heavy, and I pray that just reach down and give a special touch. Would you help us to be able to lay things aside and focus on you here this morning? Continue to guide and direct us and bless our church. In your name we pray. Amen. A couple of announcements to give you. Remember, there's no service tonight, but we'd probably cancel anyway if there was. I don't know if the name Brian Myers means anything to any of you. Missionaries in New Mexico. He was here a while ago. I'm not sure exactly how long ago that was. But they are going to be sharing with us next Sunday night. That would be the 23rd. No, that's the 21st. Now I'm mixed up. It's next Sunday night. What is it, Deb? 23rd. I know I can count on her to keep my dates straight. next Sunday night for the evening service, they'll be sharing with us. So that'll be a World Prayer Team service, and just encourage you to come out and support that. Also, council is a little later this year, and after all the cancellations and things that happened, I'm realizing it was a good thing we put it later, but it's going to be February 19th, Saturday night at 6:30. Those of you that have reports to get in, you usually know who you are, but please get them in ASAP, because we're going to be running short on time to get those printed. So just as soon as you possibly can, send them to Greg. That way he can compile them and send them to me. If you want to tag us both in that, that'd be fine as well, because I edit it before taking it to printing. So that would be fine. If you have any questions, see Greg or myself for that. But February 19th is church council. Are there any announcements I'm missing? And I've long since learned that it doesn't matter if I missed him or not, he won't say anything. For the most part, anyway.
Yeah, so for those who didn't come for Sunday school, the Valentine banquet, and my coins count.
Okay. So my coins count is the last Sunday of, how is that? Just
last Sunday of January, February, March.
Okay. And then the Valentine's banquet is February 12th. And we're trying at this point to get feelers out to see how much interest we have, because we need to solidify our caterer. Hopefully things are calm by then, but usually a lot of fun, so I encourage you to come to that. All done? All right, I switched over then, Brian.
I'd like you to turn your Bibles to Romans chapter 6. Since we're doing baptism this morning, I thought I'd use this passage. Some of you may recognize it, but I've been learning that since it has been several years since I used it, I'm probably good. But this passage is used often in conjunction with baptism. And I don't necessarily call this a full-out sermon, but maybe more of a study, a Bible study maybe, of the symbolism and sacredness of baptism. And of course, those that are joining our church have been baptized, and those of you that are here have been baptized, so maybe this will help solidify and help you to remember some of those things. I think what I'm going to do is, instead of reading the whole passage and going back and going verse by verse, I think we'll just go ahead and start and into the study and just keep your Bibles open, and we're going to just work down through this chapter and see what we can learn about baptism. And I can assure you that this in no way is going to be profound or deep, but the beauty of Scripture is that it doesn't need to be. Because God wants everyone to understand. And as Brian and Carla and I were talking this week, we were discussing, you know, getting a lot of training, which I'm not downing that at all. Sometimes it can cause you to know so much that you come across as a little bit too deep for some people. And I told Brian, I said, you don't need to worry about that with me. And he assured me that he knew that already. And but just so you know, this is not anything real profound, but it's for us all. It's not just those who are being baptized. It's for everyone here this morning. Being a Christian is a matter of life or death. Eternal life in heaven spent with Jesus, or eternity spent in hell. And that's a somber subject. And what we're going to do today is study the admonition to die. That's dying to sin and self. That may sound strange to someone who's never heard of that term before, but for us to live eternally in heaven, we need to first die to sin. So verse 1, Romans chapter 6, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Paul was telling the Romans that just because Jesus offers grace through his blood doesn't mean that it gives them a license just to keep on sinning. So many people oftentimes use God's grace as just a quick fix for living carelessly, like, oh well, God will forgive me. In fact, I was just watching a TV show the other night, and the pastor and a secretary were talking, and they were going to do something that maybe they thought, well, Christians shouldn't do, and the guy's like, oh, but Jesus will forgive us. And unfortunately, that's so often the mindset, that, oh, God's grace is just, we can do whatever we want. That's not the case. Just because God provided grace through his son's death on the cross doesn't mean we have this permission slip just to live carelessly. And several reasons why this is foolish really come to mind. Why would you want to take the chance of sinning, not knowing if your time would come or the Lord would come back during that time before you have a chance to ask forgiveness? It's just, it's like Russian roulette. It's just foolish. And also, there is no way you can grow spiritually if your heart is careless and bent towards sinning. So we need to accept this free gift of grace for forgiveness from the past and ask the Lord to help us live free from intentionally sinning. Then verse 2 gives the question, should we keep on sinning because grace covers? Certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? It's comparable to something physically dying. If you have a dog and the dog dies, it's probably not going to be running around anymore. It's not active. Yeah, and that sounds corny, but that's the way it is. When we die to sin, we shouldn't be engaging in sin anymore. It's dead. It isn't active in our lives anymore. This is referring to the death of our former life. Sin shouldn't be an option for the Christian. Because when they turn their life over to Jesus Christ, that old life, that old pattern of living should be gone. It should be destroyed. When you're saved, you should have a funeral. A funeral for your old life. It's taken and placed 6 feet under, and you shouldn't desire to dig it back up again. So how can we keep on sinning when we've died to sin? Verse 3, or do you not know that as many of us were baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death? And this verse gives us further clarification. Don't you know that when you became a Christian, you were baptized with the Spirit of God, and your old nature died just like Jesus himself physically died? Jesus Christ took on the sins of the whole world in his own body, and he completely and thoroughly died physically. At that point, there was no life left in his physical body. So Jesus Christ died to provide atonement for sins, our sins, and then when we accept this gift, we're separated from a life of sin. There should be no spark of that old sin life remaining in our hearts. And the pity is, so many people don't seem to get that. They go on living their own life the way they want to live it, all the while saying, I'm a Christian. When we get saved, we die. We die to our former life. We should start a brand new life. Verse 4. Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Some of you, maybe many of you, I'm not sure, are probably aware of the symbolism that surrounds water baptism. It's symbolic of several things, but I want to mention the biggest one. Being immersed in water during baptism is symbolic of Jesus bowing his head on the cross when he died. By entering the water, we're symbolizing that we are burying, getting rid of our sin. Then when we come up out of the water, that's symbolic of Christ rising from the dead. And our rising out of the water is symbolic of us starting a new life in him. It's a lot of symbolism there, but it's a special thing. We're burying, forsaking our old lifestyle, and we're showing those around us a testimony that we're committed to walk with him. No, baptism does not save you. Baptism doesn't cleanse you from sin. That's not what that does. It's symbolism. It's a testimony. If you go into the baptistry or the creek or whatever, a sinner, you're just going to come out a wet sinner. And I've said this numerous times, but if baptism really saves you, then there's a lot of Olympians, swimmers, that are on fire Christians because they got wet. Baptism is a public statement. And it's a humbling thing, showing people I'm serious about being a Christian. And that's why it's so exciting to me to be a part of that, because you have to humble yourself enough to do it. And being in front of people and getting soaking wet kind of is humbling. Verse 5, for if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection. The King James Version uses the word planted. If we've been planted together, it's similar to the word grafted. We died to our old life and its sin, and we're now grafted. If you know anything about grafting, it's a really cool process, how you can actually take a branch and put it into another tree and make it grow. I've never tried it, but it is a neat thing. But we're grafted into a new life with Jesus. And just as he arose from the grave, we are now getting a fresh start, a new life through him. By being grafted into him, now we're growing in this grace. Verse 6, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we no longer should be slaves to sin. And I like this verse. It's showing how sin is such a tough taskmaster. How many times have you been caught up in it, maybe in your past, or you know someone that is caught up in addictions to different kinds of sins? And when Satan tempts us to sin, he doesn't read the fine print to us and show us how it's going to affect us. How many times do you take the medication bottle and read it? Matt probably never does this. And see the side effects. I don't know if you ever heard, I think it was Jeff Foxworthy who was saying how this causes this, but I'm sure glad it cleared up, you know, my nail fungus or whatever it was he was taking for it. And sometimes you wonder if the side effects are worse than what you actually had in the first place. But Satan doesn't tell you all the side effects of sin. Oh yeah, sin's fun for a time. Don't tell me it's not. But it's only when we become trapped do we realize that there's no means of escape. Christ has offered us a way to be no longer slaves to sin. We can bury it and walk away from it. He died so we can have new life. Verse 7, for he who has died has been freed from sin. And that verse sounds like an oxymoron when you read it. But upon closer study, it's really a beautiful statement. For he who has died is free. You can't be free until you die. You have to die to yourself, desire your own desires, your pride. Like the song said, self, pride, and all sinful follies, glorious freedom, the song says. If you really want to be freed from something, you need to forsake it, you need to get rid of it, you need to bury it. Remember the verse, if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. True freedom can only be found in Jesus Christ. He'll come into your life and help you bury that sin and bondage and be done away with. Verse 8. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. And here's where the story gets incredible. If we've died to sin and we've accepted Christ as our Savior, then we will someday live with him forever. I don't know of a better life to live, honestly. I know that, like I said, sin has its attractions and it's fun for a time and make no mistake. But that's only short-lived. Anyone who's trapped in it can tell you that. The Christian life is a good life. No, it's not easy, but I'd much rather be a Christian. But the story doesn't end there. Along with that comes the blessing of living forever with Jesus. Why take the chance? What if we're wrong? What if this whole thing about Christianity and Jesus saving from sin, what if we're all wrong? Have we done anything? Are we making, is it a problem that we go ahead and go through with this? But if this is accurate, why take the risk? I don't want to risk spending eternity in hell. I just don't understand. I don't understand why someone would want to chance that. I don't want to miss heaven. Not for anything. Verse 9, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more, death no longer has dominion over him. With Jesus' death on the cross, he defeated death and all of its powers. He holds the keys to death, hell, and the grave. He has power over it. Death does not need to have power over us. Physical death doesn't need to have power over us. Because we can have the awesome promise that we're going to be in heaven. And what is death? What is this death we're talking about? It's that eternal death. Not death to sin, but eternal death. Death spent in eternity without Jesus. And because Jesus took power over all that, he has control of our spiritual death. We can die to sin. And he has control over our eternal death. We can spend eternity in heaven with him. That's a win-win situation. And I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that this is accurate. What the scripture says is accurate. And I plan on following through with it. I hope you do too. Then verse 10. For the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives, he lives to God. You know the Christmas story, the Christmas message we're supposed to celebrate all year long? Jesus came to die. I was tempted to leave the sign on the church, the message on the church sign with John 3:16, and then that's the true meaning of Christmas. I was tempted to leave that up for the year. But then it would look like I was lazy and didn't want to change the sign. But it's a very, very true message, and it would be accurate all year long. But the Christmas story is that Jesus came to die. When he died, he defeated sin forever. So his life, his death, everything he was and is, shows the great, incredible love of God for us. And it brings glory to him. Verse 11, likewise you also reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Adam Clark says, die as truly unto sin as he died for sin. Live as truly unto God as he lives with God. In other words, make sure you've buried sin. Make sure it doesn't have power over you. Be real and live a life committed to Jesus Christ. So ask yourself the question, am I alive this morning? Not physically alive, but really alive. Look around you in the world when you're out and about, and you can just see in people's faces those that have no hope and those that do. You look into their eyes, you can see it. There's emptiness, hopelessness, despair, and that's not living. We as Christians can experience and know what true living really is. Verse 12, therefore do not let sin reign in your mortal body that you should obey it in its lusts. So don't let sin have the upper hand. Let Christ bury it for you. Why should we live in misery and despair and hopelessness when we can turn to Jesus and allow him to take care of things? Let him reign in your hearts and just kick sin out. Verse 13, and do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. Let's covet together as a church this morning that we'll dedicate ourselves completely and totally over to God as instruments for him to use. Let's not in any way allow one small part of us, whether it's physically or mentally, to be yielded to something that doesn't please God. I like this term instrument. An instrument is a tool. Many of you know that I purchased a wood lathe a little while ago, and I've been making some things with that, and I showed you some of those things. I love the different instruments or tools that you use with that machine. Everyone has a specific purpose, and it's just neat. And I've even made a few myself, and it's just fun to, this does this, and this does that. It has its purpose. Every tool has its job. And I know the word tool, and I'm hoping this comes across correctly. I know the word tool can be used in a kind of a vulgar or an unkind way, but the way I'm using it, I want you to understand it's a good thing. I want to be a tool that God uses, an instrument that God uses. Make no mistake, Satan uses people too, and I've seen that happen even within the church. He has his tools that he uses, and it's people are yielded to him, and they're happy to do it, and it's sad. But let's evaluate ourselves and make sure our lives, that we're a willing tool to be used by God. We're yielded to him. Just as it states later in Romans 12, verse 1, we're to present our bodies as living sacrifices to God to use. Then verse 14, for sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under law, but under grace. Now I've discovered something interesting in studying Adam Clark's commentary on this verse. Many times we use this phrase, we're living under grace now, as an excuse to just explain away rules and traditions and whatever, then we just don't like them, so we can do away with them. We need to take this verse as a whole, this whole passage, not just this last part. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. Why does it say sin will not have dominion over you in this verse? Why? Because the law gives rules without giving any power to obey them. Jesus Christ gave us grace and forgiveness for our sins, but then he gives us the power to obey him. In other words, he's right beside us the whole way, giving us the encouragement and the strength to live victoriously. Living under the law means we got a bunch of rules to follow, but no one's helping us do it. But living under grace means God's grace helps us to obey him. Yeah, it's so hard, but guess what? He's beside us helping us the whole time. And that's what's awesome about grace. So whether you're being baptized this morning or not isn't the point. What I'm trying to make here is that we all daily need to be yielded to Christ and kill death and or kill sin and ourselves, our old self, every day. We need to forsake that. It's not just a once and done. We need to continually forsake that. When we get saved, we forsake our old life, our old patterns of living. Yeah, water baptism doesn't save you, but it does symbolize a sincerity and a desire to show the church, I'm committed to Jesus Christ. I want to do what he wants me to do. I want to live a life free from sin, and I want to be committed to God. So let's all determine together as a church that we're going to do that. We're going to live above sin with God's grace. Now give me a moment. Well, let's have a word of prayer, and then I'm going to shut the live stream off and we'll move forward. Dear Father, we thank you so much for your incredible grace that you came to help us to die to self and sin, and we just praise you for that. And then we praise you that you're helping us do that. We thank you for your word and your promises that you have in it. Help us now as we move forward with this ceremony, calm everyone's nerves, and just help us to enjoy a good time of fellowship in you, in your name.